12:20 Friday. I've got my keys. Yes.
Fine, and how are you, sir?
I'm doing all right. My name's Special Agent Matt Howard. I'm with the Georgia Bureau of Investigation.
Matt Howard.
And this is Mike Yoder.
Mike.
Yeah.
Matt and Mike.
Yes, sir.
Okay, won't you come in, please?
Oh, thank you.
And I'm Don Reynolds. I'm Mrs. DeBag's brother.
Oh, okay.
Yes.
I imagine you'll want to look at these.
I do want to look at it. Let me empty my hands here of this. She has just gone into the bathroom.
Okay. Here, I'll get out of your light there.
Matthew Howard. And Michael Yoder. I believe that's you. Yeah, fellas, I'm going to invite you to have a seat.
Well, thank you.
And she's just gone into the bathroom. I've just arrived. I live on the other street over here.
This is a nice neighborhood.
It's very nice. However, we're getting a lot of undesirables moving in here now.
That's too bad.
Yes, sir. This street and this row of apartments is only two blocks long,
mm-hmm.
going down to the foot of the hill. But when it was first built, it's only been built a couple of years. I see my sister's coming. This is my sister.
He came up and took me to the bank, but it's pouring down rain, I couldn't get out.
No.
Because I've just been out of the hospital a few days.
This is DeBag.
Hi, nice to meet
you. And this is Matt.
Yes.
Howard.
It's Mike.
And Mike.
Nice to meet you. Yoder.
Yoder. Yes.
Okay, sit down.
Where are you going to sit?
I'll sit right here.
Right there.
All right.
All right. Mind if I sit over there?
That's okay.
Fine.
That's
good.
Thank you.
And I will sit here.
A little tight. You said you would have some identification.
Yes. I've just looked at the ID.
Oh, you did? Okay.
Yes.
Well, you can look at it, too, if you want to, ma'am. I know the press is
a big
concern.
It's kind of limited, you know. It wears out easy.
Take your time, too, ma'am.
You know, I can't afford to have the media come up here because I'm on oxygen 24 hours a day and can't talk to him. I can't entertain him. I can't have him in. Sit down.
Now,
I know your feeling, actually, ma'am. I don't like having to.
Tilt that blind just a little bit down.
Ma'am.
Tilt the blind a little bit if you
will.
I can't see anything of the light behind it. Okay, that's fine.
I'm going to turn it this way.
Okay, that's good.
May I move this, ma'am, just a little bit so I can fit my stuff in here? I don't want
to. You need to go to the
table? Ma'am. No, this is just fine. Like I said, this is a quasi-informal thing. And feel free to sit down, sir.
Thank you. I want this book because I'm going to make some notes.
Okay.
Matt Howard.
Uh-huh.
And Michael Yoder.
Yes.
Okay.
What we'd like to talk to you today, first I'd like to say two things up front. The first thing is George's case against Gary, officially, except for the paperwork and things like that, he pled yesterday. So as far as...
But his lawyer is out of town, Did this come on suddenly or what?
It was something that he was aware of. It was and much before that. Essentially, and I'll kind of run you through like our role in the case. And if I talk too fast or if I use a term you're not familiar with.
Excuse me just a minute.
Uh-huh.
Can I get your son? She was very sick, and she was hard of hearing. But she has been very, very... In fact, I talked with the doctor. I didn't think she was going to make it.
Well, I'm glad she did.
Did she tell you she has cancer?
Yes, sir.
Yeah.
I had pepper on a sandwich. I just... Eating it irritated me.
Yes, ma'am. I know what that's like. As I said, the case, pretty much, as far as Meredith Emerson is concerned, he pled to that yesterday and went ahead, and the sentence has already been given, and all that sort of thing is pretty much complete as far as the court action with Gary. What we're doing now is... we're trying to find out as much as we possibly can about, because now Gary is going to be the responsibility of the state of Georgia for the foreseeable future. And one of the things we want to do is, I need to know as the investigating agent, we spend a lot of time, and I don't know if you guys watch TV and have seen like CSI and things like that. We spend a lot of time working on the how of what happened in an incident. Okay, but one thing that we always try to do as much as possible is learn the why. The how is the stuff that you see usually in court for the most part. The why is something that we need to know both for Gary, for us, and now that the fact that he's kind of in our care as far as the state of Georgia for, like I said, for the foreseeable future. The how is something that we need to know for his future, for the future of people around him, and also for other people. The how can kind of help us figure out, you know, things as far as what situations might... you know, be disegregious to him, things that he might not like to be around, that sort of thing, so we can kind of monitor him in those type of situations. One thing I want to say, and I don't know what you guys have heard on the news, but...
We hear very limited, you know, here, just what they put on CNN.
Okay. As far as the case is concerned, Gary did what he did, and he admitted to it, and gave us a lot of details about the case.
Excuse me just a minute. Now, where are you parked?
Right out front, ma'am.
Right here?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, this is somebody else's parking place.
We shouldn't be there too much longer. I mean,
you're in the dark car.
Yeah.
Yes, sir.
They'll probably come and tell us if they need...
Yeah, if it's something like that, then...
Yeah, they only limit you two places, and he's got one, I've got one. I thought I'd catch you to tell you to park behind us.
Oh, it's okay, ma'am. Okay. I know we're a little early. We don't want to take up too much of your time today, especially the weather being the way it is. But as far as the case goes, like I said, it's finished as far as Meredith's concerned, but we need to know as much as we possibly can about Gary... And just about his personality. And Gary's talked to us. I talked to Gary last night. I've talked to Gary on several occasions. One thing I've noticed about him, Gary is polite. Gary is extremely intelligent. He's well-spoken. He's very charismatic. And even though he's in the situation he's in, the people around him, generally, he gets along with everybody around him. And I have to say, a lot of the investigators have kind of, not a personal relationship, but have started a relationship with him. So, I mean, but Gary did what he did, and what we'd like to know is, on one face, you know, you have a guy that's charismatic and intelligent and easy to get along with and well-spoken, and then on the other side, we have this incident, and we'd like to understand as much as we can about Gary so we can understand that incident as much as possible. I'm going to ask you a lot of questions just about how he grew up and little details that might not, you know... they might seem insignificant, but they're actually very significant to us. Mike here works with some of the behavioral people at the FBI, and his insight and his questions and some of my questions will help them help talk to Gary and kind of understand where he's coming from and why he did what he did. And we'd like to prevent him from ever doing anything like it again, and just not only for his sake, but for the sake of people around him.
Did you... hear what his employer said.
Mr. Tabor?
I don't remember his name. It came on so sudden I didn't get his name. But said he'd worked for him 10 years. We couldn't have been too bad if he kept him employed for 10 years.
Yes,
and then
ma'am.
All of a sudden in September, he started wanting money.
Yes,
and
ma'am.
It got so bad until he had to fire him. Well, that's just about when this started. So I think something just snapped.
Yes, and that'll be some of our questions, actually, will be, and towards the end of this, I'm going to have some very specific questions about that individual.
It's just not
there.
In his nature. He read an encyclopedia like another kid would read a book, just sit and read an encyclopedia, or dictionary, whatever he could find.
That makes sense, knowing how well-read he is and how good a speaker he is. He's quite a very charismatic guy, very smart. If you could tell me a little bit, what I'd like to do is kind of, and be as detailed as you possibly can, if you could kind of tell me a little bit about Gary's father and then about when he was born.
Well, he never did know his father because he was in the military. We only lived together 3 months. He went overseas, and when he came back, didn't know it, of course, but he had another wife. So he would come to me on the weekend, said he was working out of town to open a jewelry store. So anyhow, when we tried to find him to get a divorce, so I could get some support from him, but he wasn't supporting him at all. The attorney found in about 4 different cities a person that he claimed to have been married to for years. Different people. Well, they couldn't find any record of a divorce. So we got a divorce anyhow because didn't want to get an annulment because maybe there was a divorce. He never knew his father.
Okay.
At all.
What military base was he stationed at? And can you remember his name, ma'am?
Make what?
His full name, ma'am?
The father.
Yes, ma'am.
Well, he's dead. I just found out. William Esco, ESCO, Hilton.
And he was in the Army, ma'am?
Yeah, he was. In fact, I still know
him. In the Medical Corps, wasn't he?
Yes, in the Medical Corps. I still know it. His serial number after all this time.
That's amazing. Can I have it, ma'am?
And I've never had to use it or something. It's just imprinted. And I remarried again when Gary was about 8 years old.
What was his number, ma'am?
I can't hear you.
Mr. Hilton?
Got the earache, so I got my hearing aid out.
What was that serial number?
637-5544. 44.
And where was he stationed at?
He was at Lawson General out of Atlanta. But then he went overseas to England.
And y'all, where was Gary born at, ma'am? Where was he born at, Gary?
I think it was Alabama. I don't remember just now. He said Alabama, but I've heard 2 or 3 different tales.
William or Gary?
Gary.
In Atlanta.
In Atlanta? From about the time before you remarried, was it just you and Gary?
Yes, up until Gary was about 8 years old.
Did you guys stay in Atlanta?
No, my work transferred me down to Tampa.
Tampa?
Uh-huh.
What'd you do, ma'am?
I was a supervisor in a Venetian blind factory.
Oh, neat. So after the problems with William, then you guys decided to move to Florida when you got transferred?
Yeah, you know how it is. People feel sorry for poor Cleo. Her husband left her with a child to support. I couldn't take it. So when the company offered to transfer me, I transferred.
Took the opportunity there.
And the man I was working for worked for me in Atlanta. But we got along fine.
(Clears As far as that arrangement, did you guys live in an apartment, or did you guys have a house, or?
An apartment.
An apartment. Were there a lot of kids his age in that area?
I put him in in a daycare at first after school, but it didn't work out, so I put him in the boys' club near my work, and then I would pick him up after work.
Why didn't the daycare work out? Did he just...
I don't know. He locked himself, or the door locked in the bathroom, and he cried and banged for over an hour to get out, so I wouldn't let him go back there if they don't give any more attention than that.
Yeah. Did that happen once, or did that happen like several times?
One time.
One time, and then you took him out and...
Yeah.
Okay.
How did Gary feel about that, being locked in? Was that a pretty...
Well, he was happy in the boys' club.
Okay. Wait, he didn't like it at the daycare?
He didn't say anything about it.
Really?
Because he was in one in Atlanta all the time. After that, there was a neighbor said she would keep him, a young neighbor that was married. And they got along fine. But one day the husband was acting smart and was at a park and he picked Gary up, pretended he was going to throw him in the pit with the alligators, and just scared Gary to death. So that's when I put him in the boys' club.
Wow.
This person that took care of him before the boys' club, was that, can you tell me a little bit about them? Like, just what you remember. And how long did they take care of him?
Maybe 6 months.
Okay.
And I didn't know of any problem. Gary never said anything. He never did complain much. But I can't remember their name now.
Oh, it's okay, man.
I can't remember.
Was it a male, female, old? How much older?
They weren't very old. She had a baby about 2 years old, I guess. And the man seemed to be a good influence around Gary.
Did Gary like him, or?
He never said anything about him.
Either way.
Never minded going over there. They'd go to parks and places like that, take Gary, you know, with them.
Mm-hmm. But what happened with the whole alligator thing? Just
with what?
The alligator thing, ma'am?
I don't know. The wife even came and told me, and told me, she said, I think it'd be dangerous for Gary to stay with him because he got so upset until Al, her husband, was upset too and ashamed to face me.
Okay. And what do you know about that incident? Did he, you know, just pick him up, or was it a prolonged thing?
He picked him up, held him over his head, and kept pretending he's going to throw him in the pit.
Okay. So you made the decision at that point to take him to the boys' club?
Yeah.
Okay.
And he really enjoyed that.
What did he like about it, ma'am?
I think it's just the activities just after school, you know, that he was there.
About how old was he when he went to the boys' club?
Just about 8.
Did he have a lot of friends there?
He seemed to have.
So he enjoyed, you say he enjoyed going to the boys'
club? Yeah.
Did they have like programs for sports and things like that?
Yeah, they had a rifle club, and Gary won an award, sharpshooter's award.
How old was he?
7 or 8.
Really?
Yeah.
Oh, wow.
And he'd never had a gun in his hand.
Did he continue shooting and stuff like that for competition, or?
No, he never had a gun, no.
I mean at the boys' club.
Oh, I don't know.
Okay.
I really don't know.
Were there other sports that you remember he was into besides shooting?
I don't know. He's always dirty when I picked him up. Had been doing something.
As far as like his interaction with other kids, like what would he do if he, you know, with other kids, and what would they play, that sort of thing?
They played cops and robbers. even as he was, the day he left to go in the army, I've got a picture of him. He had played the drums, and he's sitting there writing a farewell letter to his girlfriend. And you can see over under the table, there's a little car. He'd been playing with cars in the floor.
Very imaginative.
Yeah. But he was quiet, though. He wasn't rowdy.
As far as when he was about, like, 8, was he, when he first started going to the boys' club, was he, did you get the sense that he had a lot of friends there, or did he keep to himself? Oh, okay. Was he outgoing, or?
Yeah, and in the daycare in Atlanta also, because we had to meet with the teachers once a month, and they would tell us how they were doing, and she said that he was.
When did you guys move back to Atlanta?
Didn't move back to Atlanta. I married while I was there, and my husband had race horses, and we traveled a lot with the horses.
Okay. So is that when he went to school in daycare in Atlanta?
He had to change schools sometimes. Okay.
Can you tell me about your second husband? Can you tell me about the guy that owned the race horses that you married? Is that your second husband?
I don't understand what you said. I can't hear too good.
Nilo.
Yeah, Nilo what?
Okay, he wants to know about Nilo.
About him?
Yes, ma'am.
And the horses, you mean?
Well, just how you met and stuff like that. How old was Gary when you met Milo and all that?
9. And Gary liked the horses. I would go out and help my husband sometimes if he was short of help and get back before Gary got up because we had to go 5 o'clock, you know. So one day I was sick. And my husband heard Gary moving around in the other room. And he says, "What are you doing?" He says, "Well, I'm going to go help you. Mom can't go." And you know, he went out and helped him, came back and got ready for school. And he did so well, my husband got him to go every morning.
Did he like that?
Oh, yeah.
He liked working with the animals? Or?
Yeah, he really did. He would put on anybody's big old rubber boots that was in the barn there, go slopping around those big old boots. My husband was from Argentina. He had been here about maybe, let's see, 5 or 10 years. I don't remember exactly when. But they're very strict in their country because they're really an old school and it used to be more strict than it is now and it's still strict. He's very strict with Gary and wanted perfection from him, but he was also always jealous of him.
Milo was jealous of Gary? How is that? How do you mean, ma'am? How was he jealous?
I don't know. You could just tell that he resented if I did too much for Gary and not him.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. How would he express this? How would Milo express this? Like, how would he show that he didn't like that?
It's hard to say. I just knew it.
Would he yell or anything like
that? Yeah, he would yell quite a bit. He never hit him. He never abused him physically, but I would say it was a mental abuse because he would say, like when Gary was 10 or 11, "Why don't you quit and get a job, go to work?" And I'd say, "He's 10 years old. He's going to go to school as long as I can keep him in school." "Well, when I was that age, I was working, supporting the family."
So did Gary and Nilo fight a lot? Did they yell at
each other? Gary wouldn't argue back with him, but my husband would yell at him.
Okay.
But he never hit him. He never physically abused him.
What would Gary do when he was yelling at him? When Nilo was yelling at him, what would his reaction be?
He would just stand there or sit there, whatever he's doing, not say a word.
Okay. Would he do what Nilo wanted him to do?
Oh, yeah.
So he would obey him and do whatever made Nilo...
I'm sorry, but I've got an earache and I can't put my hearing aid in.
If Nilo yelled at him and told him to do something, would he do? Do that.
Oh, yeah.
Obey him.
And he did it like, you know, anybody else would. It wouldn't be like resentfully or nothing.
Yeah, okay.
I couldn't believe that. I wouldn't have been in the same position.
Was he abusive towards you, ma'am? I mean, was Milo, like, did he ever hit you or anything like that in front of Gary?
No. Uh-uh.
But would he yell at you?
He would yell, but you know, and as soon as he yelled out and said what he wanted to say, then he'd say, "I'm sorry, you know I'm crazy when I get mad. Don't pay any attention to him." He'd always say something like that.
He'd kind of minimalize it a little bit and apologize.
But there was one time that Nilo had bought him, Gary, one of the most beautiful jackets. Gary's so proud of it. And Nilo got mad about something, and he ripped that jacket all to pieces. Gary never said a word about it. It couldn't be mended. I tried to mend it. It couldn't be mended.
Did Gary have pets? Did he have pets, dog or cat? Or?
We had one most of the time. I'd say most of the time. We had a Dalmatian and a little Chihuahua. Not the whole time, because traveling it was hard to have him.
Did Gary take care of the dog, or?
Oh yeah, he would take him out trick or treating and dress him up in a scarf and paint his face and everything.
Okay. How would he paint his face?
He would take a lipstick and make a circle around his eye.
Like the Little Rascals.
Yeah. And put a scarf around his neck. He'd put on one outfit. He said, "Now go show Mama." And he'd come, the dog come prancing in there and show me. Then he'd run back. Gary'd do something that. "Now go show Mama." Hmm. He'd go back again.
Was he ever with the dogs? Was he ever really strict with them? Was he strict with the dogs?
My husband.
No. Gary.
No. No. He just loved him all the time, and the dog would sit in his lap if he could.
Okay.
Any other pets or anything like that that you can remember?
No.
What about the horses? Did Gary like the horses more than he liked the dogs?
I don't know that he would like them more, because he could pet the dog. But those horses would just knock him around and everything. He never made a move. He just kept going.
Oh, he kept trying with them?
Anytime they'd break, "It's getting away, it's getting away." I was scared to death of him.
Did that dog that, or the dogs that y'all had, did that go everywhere with him? With Gary, when he would go out like to play and things like that, did he take the dog?
Gary didn't go out like that. He went to school, and then he stayed around the house, and there's always kids of some place, because we lived in apartments all the time. We was traveling, and he would play with the kids, but he never did go out anywhere, because Gary went into service when he was barely 17.
When did you guys start traveling? Right when Gary was 9 years old?
Very shortly afterwards.
And how was that like? Did you guys like stay in one town for a little bit? Or?
Yeah, about 3 or 4 months. And then go to another one.
How long did you travel? Do that traveling?
until Gary got in the sixth grade, and then I quit traveling because he was getting in a higher grade of school. But every time he would change schools, the new teacher would try to promote him up a grade because he read so much, and every teacher said that he did good work, but he could do better. But they wanted to promote him. I think they wanted to move him up about three grades when he was in the seventh grade, up to the 12th grade. But I wouldn't do it because traveling, the next school could put him down again.
Yeah.
And that would be bad.
Yeah.
Where did you guys go during that time?
The traveling.
Yes, ma'am.
Just about every state in the Union.
Oh, that's kind of neat.
Went to Illinois, out from Cleveland. There's three tracks right there together, so we stayed there quite a while.
So, but was there like a region that you stayed in, or?
Usually stayed close to the track.
No, I mean, as far as like, did you stay in the southeast, or?
Mostly the east.
Mostly the
You're
east.
Recording this?
Just, yes, ma'am, for my
you
notes.
You didn't tell me you was recording it.
I'm sorry, ma'am, if that's, what is that an issue, or?
I'm sorry.
Is that a problem, ma'am?
You know, I'm still doubtful about
Do you need to see the badge, ma'am, or?
Beg your pardon?
Do you want to look at our badges, too? Would that help? There you go. What's that?
No, I'm sorry. Oh. No, I'm sorry.
It's not anything that, this is for our notes, ma'am. I mean, and I can turn it
I'm
off.
I'm just so scared of getting the publicity.
Ma'am, it's in our best interest, and I'm not telling you you can't talk to the press, but I usually prefer that you don't.
But none of this will be released to the press.
No, ma'am. No, ma'am.
Because
this is kept in what's called a GBI file, and then in his files, it's not stuff that's going to be publicly.
I moved here because my husband passed away after being paralyzed for almost 5 years. As soon as I got here, within 2 months, the cancer started, and so I've not met any friends. And I hate to have all this publicity come up and embarrass him and his family.
Ma'am, we don't speak to... my agency has a clause where I'm not allowed to talk to the press at all. Like, I'm not even allowed to have a relationship with the press. I mean, if it was my neighbor, it would be one thing, but I can't... If I told them any information, I can be fired for it. So it's not... And I don't make a practice of speaking to the press anyway. I was in the Army in my last job, and a reporter got me in trouble one time when I was trying to be nice to
her. The public defender told me not to talk to anyone, but she's out of the state, and nobody in her office answers. I've left a message for her.
Do you know the public defender?
I know one of them.
Which state?
For Georgia. I don't know any other state.
Georgia.
Where's she from?
I believe she's from... I believe she's from Florida,
Florida.
It is.
Okay. Because there could be several different public defenders.
And one of them in the office is Rob McNeil, and the other one, his last name is S-O-U-E-R.
What's that again, ma'am?
I may have this a little bit wrong, but it's S-O-U-E-R.
Okay. I don't think I know him.
But nobody answers.
What number were you calling? Or were you calling to Florida?
850.
Oh, okay, yeah, all right.
That's Florida.
Yeah, we don't. We usually prefer that. I mean, and like I said, I cannot tell you not to talk to the press, but it makes our life a lot easier when, you know, there's not.
How do you feel about her talking to the public defender?
That's fine. No, I wouldn't tell you not to do. The only reason why we don't like people to talk to the press is a lot of times we don't want you or you. And unless you want this, but to walk out and there be like cameras and stuff like that and that sort of thing. We don't generally.
No hair.
It's like a situation where I would never want to put you in a position where we need to talk because of Gary and everything like this, but I don't want to put you in a position where you have to make a decision. If you want to talk to the press, then you should call them. Not I shouldn't have anything to do with that. You know what I mean?
I just want to do anything that will help Gary. Because I really believe this only started after September.
After Mr. Tabor? We'll get to that, but we were talking about the traveling. You said you mainly stuck to the East Coast. Was there a place that Gary liked more than other places? Like a state or...
He hated Toledo worse than any of them.
I know what he means. I hate Toledo too. So, did not like Toledo?
No.
How old was he when he was in Toledo?
That was the first one we went to. So that was shortly after we married. We married in 55.
Did he say why he hated it? Why did Gary hate that more?
For one thing, it was cold, and we'd come from Florida. Never had cold weather, because Atlanta never did get that cold, you know. And in the school, the teacher would say, ask the kids a question. And Gary said he knew it was completely wrong, and said the teacher was like afraid of the kids. Would say, that's right, that's right. Gary couldn't stand it, because he knew it was wrong.
Smart kid. Is there a place that he liked that you can remember that that you guys traveled to that he was really happy at?
Now, he liked every one of them, except Toledo.
Did you guys stay in a city environment, or was it more like a rural type?
More like a little village, I guess you'd say. They would mainly rent to the horse people, so they would really gouge them. But my husband would have to go at 5 o'clock in the morning and come back, and then go back again at 10 o'clock and give the horses lunch, and then come back, dress again, go back for the races, then come back, and then go back again after dinner and water the horses and see that everything was all right with them.
Did Gary ever ride the horses in the races or anything like that?
Not in the races. You have to be a trained jockey.
Oh, do you? Okay. Yeah. But were these racetracks, were they in cities, or was it more of like a wooded, like smaller town type environment?
Have you ever been to a Hialeah or any of those places?
No, ma'am.
Oh, never been to one. Well, like, Hialeah has that beautiful track, but it fits in the city of Hialeah, almost downtown, and yet all the houses and apartments around that, mostly apartments, are held for the horse people.
Oh, okay.
Because they can get any amount of money they want to, you know.
How was Gary schooled at this time? Like, did he go to, was there like a, like, for the people that had to travel for the horse races, was there like a...
No, he went to a regular school,
For just 4 months, and then he'd move again?
No, it'd be 3 or 4 months.
Okay.
Yeah.
So he would... Y'all would be living in the apartment, and he would go to school while y'all were working on the horses and things like that and doing the races, and then he'd come home?
Yeah.
Did he go to daycare or anything?
No, because I wasn't working.
Oh, okay.
And I would be there for him.
How did he seem as far as when he started traveling and he was moving so much? Did he like that, or did he say either way?
He looked forward to the traveling.
Did he?
Yeah.
That makes sense.
I feel like he missed a lot not having close friends, but when I did quit traveling when the sixth grade, well, he made close buddies there.
In the sixth grade is when you guys stopped, and then where did you guys settle down?
In Hialeah.
Where's that at, ma'am?
Hialeah is just out of Miami.
Okay.
More or less like a suburb of Atlanta, Miami.
Can you spell that for me?
H-I-L-E-A-H.
H-I-A.
H-I-A.
Oh, that's right,
H-I-A-L-E-A-H.
And you said he started to have regular friends at that point. Like, he started to go to the school in Hialeah?
Oh, yeah. He was in junior high.
How did he seem as far as, did he get along with the other kids there, or?
Apparently he did. I never got any thing except good reports from the teacher. And he never stayed for after school activities. I don't know if they had them for his age or not.
Did he play any sports or anything like that?
No, because he had had a hand broken all the way across here.
Oh, how did that happen?
And it was, the doctor said to be careful of it.
How did he break his hand?
Fell out of a tree.
I broke my leg doing the same thing. When did he break his hand?
Must have been about 9 years old. When he was about the same age, I think it just before he broke his hand, I came down to Florida ahead of my husband to get us an apartment and get Gary started in school. This was in Tampa, And the apartment I rented had a bed in one of the rooms, and I didn't want the bed in that room, but it was bolted to the floor. So I had heard a sick person had lived there, and I didn't want the bed there anyhow.
Yes,
the
ma'am.
Sick person. So when I'd taken the bed down, I couldn't get the bolts out from under the bed. So I asked Gary to crawl up under the bed and take the bolts loose. It was a folding bed, that Murphy bed that goes up in the wall.
Yes, ma'am.
Collapsed on him and just took the back of his scalp off completely off like that.
Oh, my goodness.
And I got the neighbor to drive us to the hospital. Well, he stayed in the hospital a while. They took over 200 stitches. But the doctor had to ask me to take him out, that he was so active they were worried what he was going to do to his head.
So active as far as running
getting,
around?
Jumping around in the bed and getting up and playing and everything.
But did he, how would Gary like show when he was upset? Was he kind of a, was he a rambunctious child or was he?
Not really. He's very quiet.
Did he cry a lot or?
No, hardly ever cried.
Really? Quiet? Now that sounds like a dream child right there.
He was a good child. Really a good child.
About that time frame, can you remember, you told me about his hand and hurting his head. Was there any other injuries you can remember?
I don't know, but he stayed, sit all night with that hand broken and hurting, telling me it wasn't hurting. And the next morning, because when I looked at it when I went to bed, it wasn't red or so. Next morning, it was swollen up so big, there's no doubt about it, it was broken.
Was it his right hand, do you remember? Or is
yeah.
It right
hand? He's left-handed, though.
How did he react when cutting his head like that really bad?
All the way to the hospital, he'd say, "Can you see my brain? Can you see my brain?" But it seemed like he just didn't act like there's anything wrong at all.
Was Gary a lover? Did he express love with you? Like as far as would he tell you he loved you, and did he like to hug you and things like that, or was he kind of?
He wasn't very demonstrative like that because I think he felt my husband was jealous.
Prior to that?
But prior to that, he didn't either. But it's just he and I, we were close, very close, you know.
Would he kind of tell you if there was like a kid in the neighborhood that he didn't like or anything like that? Or would did he just kind of keep?
I think he would have just avoided him.
Okay. So he wasn't like, "Mom, I like this person."
No.
"And I don't like this person."
Uh-uh.
Okay. Did he, when you guys settled down in the sixth grade, did he kind of seem like he was comfortable at that point, or did he miss traveling, or did he like being in one?
I think he enjoyed the traveling. I don't know that he really missed it, but I think he really enjoyed the traveling. You know, he has been hiking all over out west and everywhere, because he sent me, I don't know, a stack like this of pictures of that he made, he and his dog, and a pickup truck, all over the mountains out there.
Could we, later on, can we look at those? Would that be all right?
You know, when I left Florida, I had to get rid of stuff to come into a one-bedroom apartment.
Yes, ma'am.
I got rid of all the duplicates, and I just kept, like, one that was representative, because I had so many pictures and things to keep.
Yes, ma'am. Can we look at it later on? Would that be okay? If that's all right with you.
Okay.
So you got, he's in the sixth grade, and then, and how is he like through junior high?
The teacher always said that he would finish his work early, and then he would disrupt the class because he wouldn't sit there quietly.
He sounds like me.
Yeah. When he was in the daycare in Atlanta, all the kids would be asleep. The teacher would leave the room to go have lunch. She thought everybody was asleep on the little cots. She came back and Gary would do things like gather all the kids' stockings and wash them in the commode. Things like that.
How did he disrupt class? When she would say he would disrupt, just talking to people, or would he throw things like I did?
Just talking, making them laugh. When he went in the Army, they made him drummer because he played the drums that go on a march, and Gary would be drumming them along. And then he'd break out in, "You ain't nothing but a hound dog." The sergeant didn't much like it. Make him get down and do push-ups.
He does sound like me. But he would just make jokes and things like that that everybody would laugh at. I know I did this when I was a kid. I was very much like Gary. I would run my mouth and make people laugh. But I occasionally got into fights and things like all boys do. Did he ever do that, or did he not?
I don't know of any fights he had. He did have one after he was in Atlanta. after he must have been in his 30s. But in his 30s, he was like a 20-year-old. But anyhow, he was selling books or magazine books from door to door. Mm-hmm. And the people wouldn't pay him. So he told them to pay him. They said, "We'll send our sample books back." And he said, "No, you pay me first." So Gary wouldn't send the books back. That was all that was said. But Gary rented another apartment, and a new guy rented the next day. I don't remember what Gary said caused it, but they got into a fight. Well, somebody called the police. Well, Gary had a warrant out for his arrest for those books. So they put him in jail.
Okay.
Yeah.
But as a kid, though, do you remember him?
No.
Just wrestling matches like boys do sometimes, you know, stuff like that?
No, I never had a black eye, no, nothing like that.
In junior high, did he ever go to any dances with girls, things like that?
Yeah. He had one special girl, and her name was Sandy. That's all I remember.
This is during junior high?
Yeah, junior high.
Was she his same age, or was she older or younger? Or
the girl.
Yes, ma'am.
They're about the same age. I think they're in the same grade, but different rooms.
You need this? I saw that it was wadded up.
They wad up because they're so little.
Yep.
Sandy was her name, ma'am, you think? Sandy?
Sandy's all I remember.
What was his relationship with her like?
He seemed to like her very much, and she seemed to like him.
Did they date for a long time?
No, they didn't really date. They
just friends.
Would, after school, they would meet, and I think walk home. She lived in Miami Springs, and we lived in Miami Springs, suburb of Atlanta.
Uh-huh.
But she lived across a canal. So she lived quite a few blocks farther away than he did.
Did you guys move from Hialeah to Atlanta?
When we came back to Atlanta.
Yes, ma'am.
Never moved back to Atlanta. Gary went to Atlanta after he came back from service.
Oh, okay.
And his wife divorced him. He lived right around the corner from us. We could walk through our backyard and be in his front door.
Oh, that's nice.
They moved there by, behind us, and they divorced. One day they're at the races, all hugged and kissing. Next day, we're separating. Never any fighting or nothing. Well, I didn't know until years later. I would ask him what was wrong. He said, we just couldn't get along. We just didn't want to live together. She was a drug pusher, and I didn't know it.
Oh, my goodness. As far as... But during junior high, you guys were still in Florida, near Miami?
Yes.
So, did he date any, can you remember him hanging out with girls or anything like that?
No, he was pretty young, you know, about 13.
Okay.
Yeah.
Did he go to high school down there?
In Hialeah.
Okay.
Because by then, we had gotten a house, and we had moved to Hialeah.
What was he like in high school? I know that I was kind of rambunctious when I went to high school because, you know, boys are going through their, you know, puberty and stuff like that. Was that how he was, or was he just, you know?
He must have been pretty quiet because he was playing the drums and he would practice after school with the other boys and the drums. And in about the last month of his senior year, he dropped out to play in his drums in a nightclub. And I wouldn't sign for him to drop out. And the principal finally wrote me and told me I might as well, because he was going to keep on until they suspended him and said that would look bad. So I let him drop out. And he promised he would get his GED. But he didn't get it until he went in the Army, and then he finished it. And then after he came out, he was working two jobs and going to college in the daytime, too.
So did he like playing music in the nightclub? Or?
Oh, yeah. But as soon as they found out how old he was, because he was 15 or 16, I guess it's 16, they wouldn't let him play anymore.
Mm. So, and he's still, this is still in Florida, this nightclub, right? The nightclub was in Miami, or?
Miami Beach, yeah. And we lived in Hialeah.
Did he date girls in high school?
I don't know of any besides Sandy. Because every spare minute he was with those drums.
Did he?
Oh. You want to take your jacket off? Are you warm?
Oh, I'm fine.
Oh, okay.
Thank you.
Did he go to dances or anything like that, or did he just focus on the drums?
I don't think they really had many dances.
Oh, that's a shame.
I never heard of them. He was so sensitive. One time my husband was talking to me and said, Now, this week we're going to be pretty tight, so we're going to have to tighten our belts and watch what we spend. That was all that was said. Gary wasn't even in the room. And at the end of the week, he came to me and handed me all of his lunch money. He hadn't eaten lunch all week. Says, I heard you and Dad talking about being broke, and so I saved you my lunch money. He was so sensitive like that.
Wow. How, as when I got older, when I was in high school, my dad and I would kind of butt heads a lot, you know. Was that like that for Gary as well with Milo, or?
Always, always. It's a constant. I left my husband 7 times just for things like that. And he would promise, no, it's me, you know, I'm crazy, I'm just crazy. No, no, we'll go to counseling. He'd go to counseling 1 time and then he wouldn't go anymore.
How would that kind of show itself, the differences between the two of them? Would
they? It's just my husband yelling and breaking things.
Oh, he would break things, okay. Yeah. In front of Gary?
Yeah.
But did he ever hit him or anything like
never,
that?
Never hit him. He one time had a belt or something, and he would hit the door and hit the door frame and like that, but never hit Gary.
How would Gary, as he got older, did he stand up to him a little bit more, or was he still passive?
He wasn't at home after he got older, you know, but 17.
Well, I mean in high school, you know, yeah. did he?
And he was busy every afternoon with his drums.
Okay.
So he wasn't around much.
Well, Gary was saying that he had an incident with Nilo.
He what?
He had an incident with Nilo. It was a bad incident when he was about 14.
Yeah.
Can you talk about that?
I'd rather not discuss this in front of him.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay.
Was he always interested in the military?
And when he came home on his leave, I think they trained for like 30 days, came home and leave. He did push-ups every day to stay in shape.
He is definitely in good shape.
Yeah. I think he would have made a career of it if he hadn't married this girl in Germany.
What did he do? Like he was working at the nightclub, and they said he couldn't work there. He was 17 when he joined the army. It was right after that.
I think he was 16 because he would have graduated high school when he was 16.
Okay.
So he must have been just 16.
What did he do? I know he joined. He wasn't. I know the draft was around back then, but
no.
What?
I had left my husband again, and Gary was going out every night, and I'd say, where are you going? He says, Mom, I am just walking around. I'm not doing nothing. I'm just walking around. One night he woke me up about midnight and says, Mom, I just wanted you to know, you know, I've been walking every night thinking. And he says, I'm going to get in trouble with nothing to do. So I joined the Army today. First I knew about it. I didn't really know what he was doing. I was worried about him walking, but I didn't know what else to do.
Did he seem excited about it?
He was happy to go. And he talked one of his friends into joining at the same time. So they left on the same train. And the father was so mad at Gary. Talking the guy into going, and they both went to paratrooper school, and they had 500 men from all over the world that came there at Fort Benning to take paratrooper training, and Gary was in the top 10 of the 500, and he was 17 years old.
Both Mike and I were in the Army, too, so.
Beg pardon?
I was in the Airborne, too.
Oh, is that right?
Yes, ma'am.
Yeah, me too. Yeah.
I went to see him graduate and saw him jumping. Oh, boy, my heart was in my throat.
Did he say that? Did he think he was going to Vietnam? Or I know that was right about that time.
They didn't tell him. I got my aunt to go with me. She lived in Atlanta, and I was living in Hialeah. And I got her to meet me in Atlanta at the airport and go with me out there. And we were only allowed to stay on the base 3 nights, I think it was. And his, I don't know, colonel or what it was, came to us and told us, says, I just want you to know, Gary's shipping overseas tomorrow. If you want to stay another night, you can stay another night.
Oh, that was nice of him.
Yeah. And you know, we went to dinner at the mess hall or someplace there on the base. I told my aunt, I said, now I'm sure that he, after being up here with all these men and in the army, that he's drinking beer. So let's you and I order a beer so he'll feel comfortable if we want to. So he gave the man our order and said, 2 beers and 1 glass of milk.
What did he like? Did he say he liked the army?
Yeah.
Did he, I mean, when he said going overseas?
He re-enlisted, you know.
Yes, ma'am.
And served 2 years of the next hitch, but then he married and he came home.
The did he didn't go to Vietnam or did?
No, he went to. Germany.
Okay.
Germany. Because that's where he met his wife. But he made the Green Berets before he got out.
How did he feel about that? I mean, was he very proud of it, or
yeah,
he like that, or?
But he didn't get into it because something was holding up the shipping out of the guys or something. I don't remember what it was. So, but he already had his pen and his beret, and just waiting to be shipped to it. Didn't know where they were going.
Mm-hmm. How did he meet his wife over there, or the girl he met in Germany?
I don't really know how he met her.
Did he write home to you about that and say this,
yeah,
mama met this great
and
girl?
Said they were going to marry, and I was planning on going over there. And he wrote me and told me they had already married.
Was she older than him? Or?
No, I think she's the same age. At least she said she was, but she was an architect. And I thought, that's awfully young to be an architect. But then he was 21 by then.
How old was she?
21. Because it's 4 or 5 years after he was over there. He went in when he's 17, so 21. So she had to be about, no, I think she's a year or two younger than him. A few years after they were divorced, my husband and I moved to Argentina. And my husband told me, he said, you go back to the States and take 2 plane tickets. And you get Ursula and Gary to come down here and live. And said, just down here together, maybe they'll be all right. And they had been separated or divorced. I don't know if there's divorce yet or not. So I went to Gary and asked him, would you go down there and live? He said, yeah, I'd like to do that. And I said, well, I'm going to go ask Ursula. So I went to her and asked her, and she says, well, I tell you, with Gary, I didn't have nothing. And with this man, I've got a good clothes, I got a car to drive. And I said, no, I won't go.
So he didn't want to come either?
No. Hmm.
Did he ever say why they broke up?
Finally, after...
Oh, well, wait a minute. How long were they married, ma'am? They got married when he was 21, and then they were married for...
must have been just 2 or 3 years. I cannot remember exactly. This chemo affects your memory. They say it's short-lived, it'll return, but I'm hoping.
Well, mine's affected just in general. I have a hard time remembering where my car keys are.
Well, what do you expect from 82 years old?
Did he want to come down there without her or to
Argentina? No, he wouldn't come without her, he said. I think he's always hoping.
That it would...
Yeah. And he didn't get on the drugs or drinking either one until, years after they divorced.
You said she was a drug pusher. Was she selling, like, narcotics, like marijuana or something?
Yeah, well, when I first saw her, I thought then she's on drugs because her eyes were dilated, you know, and stayed dilated all the time. And always like that. I never saw them when there wasn't.
Did she act strange? Or?
Yeah.
Did you ever say anything to Gary about it?
No, I never did because I didn't see her taking any or doing anything like that.
Just something in the back of your mind.
Yeah, but I didn't want to offend Gary either.
How was Gary if you were talking to him and he got offended? How did he react to stuff like that back when he was younger? I was kind of a hothead. That's the reason why I asked. So.
I don't remember saying anything that offended. If I scold him for anything, he'd just say, okay, Mom, okay.
Did him and Ursula, did they seem to get along in general?
I never saw him. There's always, anywhere he would go, she would go, and the same thing. They're always acting like they're crazy about one another.
Did they hold hands and that sort
yeah.
of thing? That, okay.
Hug and everything. Just the day before, I told you that's at the races, and sitting there on the bench, hugging and kissing, just like kids.
Did they think about having kids?
Never said anything to me about it.
Did you ever ask them?
No.
I know my mom would call every day waiting for grandchildren, so.
No, she was working as an architect. I got her at a job at the company I worked for.
Uh-huh.
And she is an architect then. I think she was happy with her work.
Where was this at? Was this in
Florida? That was in Florida.
So when he came back from Germany, right?
Yeah. Florida.
They came to Florida?
North Miami Beach.
About what year was this? Do you remember?
He was 22. So that was... It must have been in the 60s, but I couldn't tell you.
No, it's okay.
I could sit and figure it out, but my brain won't take it.
It's all right, ma'am. So he comes back to Florida, and then what? You said one day they're at the races, and the next day they're just not together anymore?
No, he just said we're separating.
Okay. And did
she told me first, and then I asked him, he said, yeah.
Did he seem depressed, or did he say, Mom, I'm really upset, or anything like that?
Well, he seemed sad, but he didn't cry or nothing.
Cleo, it might be worthy of note to mention Gary was a pilot. Wasn't he?
Yeah, at the college he was going to after he got out, he was taking flying lessons, and the school wanted him to stay on as an instructor. And this was just about the time that they separated, I believe.
Did he like flying?
Oh, yeah, he really liked it. He flew me and his wife to from Florida, Miami to Pompano. No, we drove, the wife and I drove to Pompano. He took a plane in Miami and flew up to Pompano. We met him and got on the plane with him there because they wouldn't allow him to take passengers in Florida. And he flew us up to Silver Springs, which was up more than halfway the state of Florida.
Oh, wow.
I'm sitting here holding my seat like this.
How did everything work out as an instructor? Did he stay in that job for a long time?
No, I think that's just about the time that they separated.
Mm-hmm.
And he just gave up both of his jobs.
What was his other job?
One of them was delivering and picking up guard dogs because he was going to school. And the other one was exterminator.
And then he got a job as an instructor, or was this just a side thing for him?
I think he just fell to pieces then. Oh. Just didn't care what he did.
Oh, when she left him, or yeah. When they separated? That's understandable.
I can't remember when he gave up the apartment. I just can't remember.
Before this time, right before the divorce, and I'll ask you about after, did he do a lot of camping and things like that? Was that a big thing for him, camping and going to parks?
My husband was traveling a lot to South America. He would go down there and buy horses, then he'd have to wait till they passed quarantine. So we would go together, the three of us, Ursula, Gary, and I. My company had a cottage down in the Keys. We'd go down there and spend the weekend, or we'd go down to Key West and spend the weekend, or go up to Orlando or something like that. We went someplace almost every weekend that my husband was out of town.
Okay. So he would he camp, or would y'all stay in like cabins or little cottages?
No, we had a cabin.
Oh, okay. Oh, great. And you would go there every time to the Key West place, or most of the time?
We'd go there a lot, yeah.
When after he separated with Ursula, did he start to spend a lot of time by himself, or did you see as much of him?
I can't remember that time at all as to what he did or anything. I just cannot remember.
When you start remembering again, like after, like...
I don't even know where, I can't even think where he lived, because I don't believe he kept the little apartment. It was a little house, and I cannot remember.
Okay. But he just stopped working as far as you knew it? And just kind of depressed.
He stopped working there, but I know he worked someplace because he had an apartment someplace, but I can't remember where he went from there.
Did he stay in the area where you were at, or did he just leave like the whole
state? I can't remember a thing that happened after that.
Okay.
I don't know why, I just cannot remember.
Do you know when he moved, like, up to Georgia?
No, when he what?
Do you remember when he moved, like, to the Atlanta area?
Shortly after, that's what happened. Shortly after they separated, he did go to Atlanta. And he got a nice apartment up there near Stone Mountain. And I would go up there about once a month and spend a weekend with him and have him fix his apartment. I remember that.
What did he do when he went up there? Do you know what he did for a living? When he...
I can't remember.
It's okay.
I know he was working because he left me his car while he was gone.
What kind of car was it?
It was a black sporty car, but I can't. Oh, it's a Camaro.
Yeah, I remember he mentioned that, actually. He really liked that car, I think.
Yeah.
That was a high-dollar car back then.
Yeah.
So he must have been doing very well.
Yeah. And he would, you know, do you know what Stone Mountain is?
Yes, ma'am.
He would, every weekend, climb up on that mountain. And he met a girl there. Her name was Sandy, too. No, her name was Sean.
How did they meet? Do you remember? Did he ever tell you how they met? It's okay. There's no. Did they get married or?
Sean, as far as I know, they didn't. He never told me if they did.
Okay. What did he say about Sean?
Well, he was with her a long time, several years. But I believe he talked like she's a friend.
Oh, okay.
But I really don't know.
Did he like her a lot or ever say anything like that to you?
He seemed to care for her a lot.
Did you ever meet her?
No.
They never got married as far as you know or anything like that?
He never said anything about it.
Did he get married again, ma'am?
I was just thinking. I believe he married a girl with two children during the time that he was there.
Did you go to the wedding or?
I didn't even know it till he called me and told me that he's married.
Did you meet her? Did you meet his wife?
I met this girl. Gary was working or sometime, so I went out to Stone Mountain and stayed at the base of it. I didn't go up on it. And this girl came out. She had a uniform. I think she was a park ranger or something like that. I'm not sure what it was. And she told me that she was Gary's wife, that they had separated. And she didn't say anything bad about Gary or anything.
Did he ever say anything about her after they separated?
No, never told me anything. And he called me after they were married and talked to me, and the girl talked to me. But it was such a short time they were together until I really didn't get acquainted with her.
Did he like the kids or anything like that?
He seemed like they did. He did.
And did he ever tell you why they split up? Like, just never gave you any idea, or did you have a theory why?
No, I never had any idea at all why they separated.
Did you ever ask him?
No.
Just his business type thing?
Yeah.
Did he change after that breakup, or was there like a, was there anything?
I couldn't notice any difference, but I wasn't seeing him very much then. Because he had started on drugs then, because I could smell it in the car. And I quit going up there every month because I was afraid he would get stopped and there'd be drugs. I was afraid there'd be drugs and I would be along with him.
Mm-hmm. So did you tell him you weren't going to, did you say that to him? that you were going to hang around with him if he was going to do that?
He told me, he said, well, Mom, I don't use much of it. And said, that's better than if I was drinking and drunk all the time, isn't it? Don't you think that's better than being drunk? And he says, I don't use that much of it.
Is he talking about marijuana? Or what was he, did he mention what it was? He
didn't say what it was.
Was it stuff you smoke? Like a cigarette?
Or? Yeah, more like a cigarette, but a little different smell.
Did he tell you what he was doing for a living or anything? Like when he bought the Camaro?
He did a lot of telemarketing.
Okay. Did he have like one address in that time frame? Like, and I'm thinking of the 1980s. Did he live in a bunch of places or anything like that?
I never had an address because I never called him. I only called him. I never wrote to him anything. I'd call him ever so often.
How often did y'all talk during that time frame when he was doing drugs and things like that?
Well, it would vary. Sometimes it'd be every week, sometimes once a month.
Okay. As far as the 1980s, can you remember him dating anybody else or having a relationship with anybody?
After he was married.
Yeah, after the divorce or they got separated.
Well, you see, it wasn't in Miami. So I really don't know.
I don't know. Just if he ever mentioned anything, like, I've got a girlfriend, Mom, or anything like
no.
that.
No. It's always this Sandy. She was over a period of time.
Okay.
Yeah.
Is that Sandy or Sean?
Sean,
okay. But he would, all throughout, like, as best you can remember, I know it's a long time ago, but through the 80s, even towards the late 80s, did he mention her in the 90s he would talk about Sean, or...
He was always talking about her. Sent me pictures of her and him.
Oh, well, that's nice. And this is another crazy detail I know. It's probably not going to make much sense. But can you remember the cars that he was driving back then? You said he had a black sporty car. And then what did he have after that? If you can remember. It's no big deal.
That's the last car I ever saw him with. But in all the pictures he sent, there's a pickup truck with a camper on the back of it.
Do you remember what color it was? Well, do you have the picture around? We can look later. Would that be all right if I just look at it?
I don't know if I have a picture of that or not.
We'll check it out. You knew he was doing telemarketing. Was there a time when he, like, stopped doing drugs, or was that, like, a constant problem? Because I know moms don't want their sons to use drugs.
If he did what?
Did he ever stop using drugs?
I don't know. he never seemed spaced out or anything when I talked to him.
Okay.
Even when I was there and I could smell him, he never acted any different.
Okay. Did he ever smoke cigarettes or drink?
Before he started drugs, he was drinking wine. That's the only thing I ever knew him to drink, and alcohol.
Okay. Would you say that he was still talking about Sean, like, recently? Like after the year 2000 or in the 90s?
I have no idea.
Okay.
Gary got upset with us and it was my fault. But when he was in jail for when the man was for out a warrant for him, getting out of breath, I'm going to have to go on the oxygen. He called and wanted to know if I would send the money for his bond to get out. At that time, my husband had just fallen for a scam one of these lotto scams. I got a ticket that's a winner and so forth, $10,000. And he had to get it on a credit card, which was covered by his bank, and then found out it was a scam. We had to scrape together everything we had to pay that. Okay, so when Gary called and asked for it, I told him I absolutely just did not have the money. And I thought, well, if that's the only thing it is, it won't be, he won't be in there but just a few days anyhow. So I didn't worry about it. And then when he got out, he called me and told me that this Sean had paid his bond. And I said, I don't remember how I said it, but I said, it took all Nalo's life savings to make the $10,000. And he said, you mean he had $10,000 and wouldn't get me out of jail? And hung up. I didn't speak to him again. That's the last time I spoke to him, I think.
Really?
I didn't know where he was.
I mean, since then you didn't speak to him?
And really it wasn't life savings. I don't know how, why that came out, because it was $1,000 here, $50 there, and another $100 here.
Yes, ma'am.
It's just that we scraped it together.
So the last time you talked to Gary was how long ago? About 10 years, or was it?
It's been at least 10. I'd say at least 10.
At least
10. Now, I haven't seen him, though, since about 86 or 87.
He wants some oxygen.
Yeah.
Is there a reason why you didn't get to see him much?
I didn't know where he was.
After 87?
He was upset thinking that we had $10,000 we're sitting on and wouldn't help him.
Oh, that's the last time you talked to him.
Right.
In 87, when you stopped seeing him face to face, or the last time you saw him was 1987, was there a reason why that happened, or did he ever say anything to you?
I quit going up there because I was afraid of the drugs in the car.
Okay.
Is it on?
No. Okay, the button.
That's it. That's it.
So Gary didn't come, he didn't want to come down to visit you after that?
I don't know if he didn't have the money or what.
Okay.
And since I thought it was on drugs, I knew my husband would be upset. So I didn't say anything to him about coming.
Okay. Would he send letters to you? Would he send letters to you, write letters to you, or anything?
He would call, or I would call.
Okay.
But after that time, I think that $10,000, he never called again. I didn't know if he's dead or alive. Are those people home yet? Is the girl home yet?
Nope.
One of the things, we're looking at Gary's history, kind of looking back, and he got into an argument with somebody, and that person accused him of lighting a car on fire. Did he ever talk to you about that?
About what?
An incident where somebody said he'd lit a car on fire. Did he ever do anything like that as a kid? We're trying to figure out if that really happened or not. And did he ever light small fires?
Oh, a barn, you said?
Yes, ma'am.
I didn't know he set it on fire. But he had gotten mad with my husband about something. or my husband, together they were mad. And he was staying over there at this kid's house. They had a storage shed in the backyard.
Yes, ma'am.
And that caught on fire. I didn't know Gary. I asked him, did he do it? And he said no.
Did he get in any trouble for it?
No.
Okay. Did he ever talk about the same incident, but when he was older, where there was a car that caught on fire? Okay.
Never knew about that.
How old was Gary when that barn fire happened?
Probably 14.
14. And so he said, initially when asked, he said he didn't do it?
Right.
And then why do you think he did do it after that?
I don't know. I didn't. Just now is the first time I knew he did it.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
But he was there. Was he there at the time?
Yeah.
Okay. Did the whole barn?
I don't think so. I don't think so, because they called the fire department, and I think before it got burned, they called.
As far as that, can you remember any other fires or anything? Anything that he liked fire? When I was a little kid, I used to play with cap guns and make campfires and stuff like that. Was he like that?
I never remember of any of playing with fire or anything.
I mean, even just campfires and how boys are sometimes when they...
Not around the house. If they did it off someplace, I don't know, but not around the house.
Is there anybody you can think about that was like a lifelong friend for Gary? Like somebody that he was friends with when he was in high school that he still talked to, like in the 80s or 90s?
No, because he left Atlanta.
Okay.
Florida, way before that.
Okay.
I think he left around 70 or maybe earlier.
When I was about 14 or 15, I started hunting a lot. Because I grew up in South Georgia, hunting and fishing and that sort of thing. Did he do that? Did he start hunting and fishing or...
Any what?
Hunting or fishing or anything like that?
When he and Ursula were married, they lived on a canal, a big canal, and he would fish from there.
Did he ever go hunting? Did you ever, even as a kid?
We never had a gun.
Not even like a BB gun or anything like that?
I think he had a BB gun when he was about 9 or 10, but I don't even remember what happened to it. I don't remember him ever using it. He wasn't interested in it, seemed like. He liked riding his bicycle. He would ride it for miles, training to make a trip around the United States.
How did he react, did he have a lot of girlfriends? I know we talked about this a little bit, but...
I don't think he had a lot of them, because traveling so much, he never had time to really cultivate them.
Was he interested in girls a lot? Some guys more than others, some guys aren't that interested.
Well, he seemed real close with this Sandy, and then, I don't know in Germany if he had a lot of them or not, but those would be his dating years if he was dating at that time.
I'm going to look through my paperwork if you got it.
Good, I'm getting hoarse.
It's okay, ma'am. I appreciate all your help. The one thing I would like to know a little bit more on, and I know it's not easy for you, and I understand that it's a little bit difficult, but the incident between Nilo and Gary when he was 14, can you tell me anything about that? Because we think that that's got a lot to do with some of his, and we need to know what happened if that's possible. And I mean, just so we can understand what happened. And you take your time and take as much time as you want, ma'am.
Well, it was during the time I didn't want to discuss this.
And I appreciate the fact
with
that
there's somebody here.
Would you like? Do you want to wait a minute, ma'am, or would you like to just do it you and me? Would that be a little more comfortable?
Either one.
That's fine.
Since you want me to go out while you talk to him,
would you just wait on the porch just a few minutes?
I'll be happy to. I may know the gist of what you're going to say, but
I've never talked to anyone at all about this.
Right. Okay.
I'm sorry, Don.
That's hey. No problem.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir.
Yeah. I know when I'm not the one.
Well, that's all the time.
I'm going home.
Oh, look at the sun shining. Y'all better let me go to the bank.
Oh, ma'am, this is our last question, and then we'll be leaving
okay.
After this.
Because I couldn't go, and he came over to take me to the bank.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, I'm going to make this fast. During the time that I had left Nalo, before Gary went into the service, Nalo would come to the house every day. Nalo's my husband. He would come to the apartment where I was every day, begging us to come back. He had promised Gary all kind of things, you know. He did all, every time we left, he'd promised Gary. And he would keep his promises. But he came over, and Gary had a gun that was a friend of his gun. And he had asked him to let him keep it overnight. So I guess he had plans, I don't know. And he told Nalo, said, now Nalo, Mom doesn't want you here, and she doesn't want to go back to you. Now, if you don't leave, I'm going to call the police. He said, call the police. I don't care. He said, well, I'm going to shoot you then. And he said, shoot me. Go ahead, shoot me. And he grabbed the mattress off the bed, held it in front of him, says, now shoot me. I dare you to shoot me. Gary shot him. But he shot him down here, and he was a sharp shooter. He could have hit him in the face if he'd wanted to kill him, but he hit him here.
In the legs or in the
stomach, lower part of the stomach.
Okay.
And after that, they wouldn't let Gary come home again. And I went to counseling too, and I was foolish for listening to him, but they told me my duty was to my husband, the counselor did. And you know, your duty is to your child, especially if it's a child you had when you married. But I listened to the counselor, but they wouldn't let him come home. And there was a woman that came and told me that she, that Gary and her son were friends, Harry Keller, and that she would be happy to take him to her house and keep him as long as they required him to. So I let her keep him. I don't remember how much I paid her. And that's when he got started on his drums. And I bought the drums for him thinking that would keep him pacified and happy enough. He seemed happy enough, but then some of them in the family, I don't know who, started having problems. And he told me, he says, I'm going to have to leave there. I can't stay there. Well, they still wouldn't let him come home. So he had I don't know if you'd call him a probation officer or what, because he was in juvenile hall.
Excuse me just a minute. Did you check your mail?
No, I haven't.
I'm going to walk down there while you're talking.
Okay.
And I'll check your mail.
Then you got the key?
I think I've got it here in the car.
If not, you can get mine.
I'll check.
Okay.
All right.
So, they, I talked to this counselor, Martin Vegg was his name. That was Martin-Vegg, V-E-G-U-E. He told me, he says, well, get him a room in something like a motel but apartment building that you know is a good neighborhood and everything, and let him stay there because he was 16 then. Yeah, 16. So I did, and I would take him meals over there and give him money to go eat with and kept as close a tabs on him as I could, but they still wouldn't let him come home. So then I told them that I was going to leave my husband, and would they let Gary come home then? So I did get an apartment, and Gary came with me then. And that's when he joined the Army after we were in the apartment a while.
Did he ever spend time at a youth detention center?
A what?
A detention center after that?
Not after that, after the shooting.
After
yes.
The shooting?
Yeah.
He went to a detention center?
And that's when the woman got him and took him to her house.
Okay.
Juvenile hall, they called it, okay. In Atlanta.
Okay.
I didn't want to talk about my brother. I've just never... I didn't want to get a wrong impression of Gary because that was not typical of his conduct. And I didn't want... Because they've never been around Gary.
Mm-hmm.
He was a minister out in Colorado and so forth. And I was over here and traveling with the horses. And now, this time, is the first time we've been together. Well, since we were 10 and 14 years old, we've only been together a few hours.
That's nice.
So we hardly knew each other.
That's nice to have that, though, somebody to be close to.
Well, I had nobody in Florida at all. Had a lot of friends, but no family at all. He's the only family I have. And he came down so I wouldn't be alone mourning my husband and everything. And he said, when he started to leave, he said, "You're going to have to move someplace. Why don't you come up there and be near us?"
We have a lovely home, ma'am. Did Gary have any brothers or sisters or anything?
No.
Did Nilo not have any children?
I lost a child a couple of years after we married, but never had one.
How did that affect Gary? When?
You know, he had to call the ambulance for me.
Can you tell me about that, ma'am?
What?
Can you tell me about that, what happened?
Well, my husband was at the track and running horses, and there's no phone calls allowed to come in at that time. Because at that time, they wouldn't let you call in on account of betting, you know. And so I could tell I was miscarrying. And so I asked Gary to call the doctor's office and tell him that I was miscarrying. He didn't know what miscarrying was. And to send an ambulance, because I knew Gary couldn't call an ambulance. He was like 9 years old or 10, something like that. So he did, and I had to leave him alone there in the apartment until my husband got in from the track, you know. And actually, he was scared to death.
Gary was?
Yeah.
I can understand that.
Yeah.
Did he go to the hospital with you or anything?
No. They didn't let children in at that time.
And he never had any kids? Did he ever have any children that you know of? Any
grandchildren? He told me he didn't.
Okay.
He kept telling me, he said, "Mom, don't give up. Some of these days you'll have a grandchild." But I never knew of any.
Okay. And you can't remember him fight other than the time with Nilo. Was there any other fights between him and Nilo? Or did he ever say, you know, I hate you or anything like that towards his dad?
He never said, "I hate him," to me, but I could tell that he didn't like him. I don't know, you just get that sense.
Yes,
know?
Ma'am.
And that's why I was always leaving Nilo, trying to work things out, because I really cared for my husband. And and my husband really worshiped the ground I walked on. he would get mad with me too and yell and scream, but then he'd always say I'm crazy, and he did have a terrible temper.
Did he and Gary ever spend any time alone with one another or anything like that? Like, did he try to hang out with Gary and it just didn't work out? No.
Okay. He spent so many hours with the horses, because even though he was the trainer, he was responsible for the horses. He would spend so many hours with them, he'd be exhausted when he'd come in.
Okay. Ma'am, the only thing I got left is I just need some personal information from you real quick. Can you tell me Nilo's full name and spell it for me?
When he got his citizenship paper, he dropped his middle name.
Okay.
So his name is Nilo, N-I-L-O.
Okay.
Divide, D-A-V-A-G.
Okay. And then can I get your full name, ma'am?
Okay, I use Hilton as my maiden name, as my middle name, on account of Gary's name was Hilton. So Cleo Hilton DeBag is what I go by.
Okay. Now I've got your address. Can I get a, do you have a cell phone, or do you just have the phone that I called you on earlier?
This one here.
Okay.
I don't use a cell phone. I don't know enough people here to call.
And can I get your social security number and your date of birth, please?
Why do you need my social security number?
What we do a lot of times, ma'am, is if we have to bring somebody in, like, to speak for Gary or something like that in any kind of proceeding, people move a lot. Like, if you move to your brother's house or something like that, and we need your social to find out where you live at. Because sometimes this will be like a year from now before we ever need you or something like that. You don't have to give it, ma'am. It just makes it easier for us to find you.
It's not necessary.
It's not. If you don't feel comfortable, don't worry.
I'd rather not, you know, because
that's
I'm
fine.
Afraid somebody else will get it.
Like, can you give me your date of birth, though? Would that be?
6/6/25.
6/6/25? Okay. And did you retire from your company, the Venetian Blind Company, or?
Well,
or did you go back to them?
That one I quit and started traveling. But I retired from one 3 different times, and they called me back every time. And so I kept going back, and they finally sold out, and a man bought it for his 19-year-old daughter, and she ran it into the ground. A chain of 61 stores.
Oh, wow.
And she ran it in the ground, so it left. And I went to another one, AARP. I worked for them a while.
Oh, neat.
Then I went to Meals on Wheels, a supervisor, area supervisor for the Meals on Wheels. I retired from there in 98. Hmm. But I'd only been there like 7 years.
Ma'am, I have a question. Before you moved here, you lived in Hollywood, Florida?
Hollywood.
Did Gary ever visit you there?
No, he never saw that house.
Okay. Did he call you while you lived there?
Yeah, that's where the last time I talked to him was there.
Okay, so that would have been when around the mid-90s when he called? When was the last time that you talked to him on the phone?
That was the time I lived there at that house.
But that was when?
About the $10,000.
About the $10,000?
Yeah.
Okay.
Thank you. Ma'am, I appreciate all your help. And this is the kind of stuff that we need just to give a picture of what kind of guy he is and all that and what, you know, what are things that upset him. Oh, ma'am, you can have a seat. Don't.
Okay.
Are those the pictures, ma'am?
Yeah. When he left Atlanta, the school there, the teacher cried when he left. That's just a school picture, baby pictures. I'm looking for the campus. Come on in.
Is the coast clear?
Yes,
the
sir.
Coast is clear.
All right.
See what a beautiful Charlie was. Okay. This is one of his early.
Oh, that's really early.
Military pictures. I'm looking for the. This is at the paratrooper school when he was graduating. This is he and that's Sandy. And this is when he was, the night he left for the Army.
Oh, he looked like he was in good shape.
And getting on the train.
Wasn't he a handsome young man?
Strapping young man.
Yes, he is.
And as a child.
Did you go to Fort Bennington?
Yes, ma'am.
Prettiest boy.
See his
that green. Wall's still there, just so you
is
know.
It really?
Yes, ma'am.
What's that?
That's not him. This is he and his wife in Germany.
This is Ursula, ma'am?
Yeah. I don't find
is
it.
Is that Ursula on this one?
No, that's me.
Oh, I'm sorry.
I don't find the camping pictures. Here's one of the pictures from where he was camping. See, he's always got his dog with him.
Yeah.
That's beautiful. Did he say where this was from?
Same place.
Where, do you remember where he said this was, ma'am?
It's out west to someplace.
Okay.
These are all camping. Anyways.
Looks like he's in great shape.
See, he had a tent and everything. He couldn't get an apartment that would accept his dog at a rent he could pay.
Oh. So he lived in the storage shed?
Yeah, and he sent me a picture of how it was fixed up inside. This is another trip camping because, see, it's colder weather. These are all camping. Any mail?
He had just arrived and was starting to put it up, and he said it would be about another 15 or 20 minutes.
Is that right here? And these are just from his travels, ma'am, where he drove all around, or just trips he'd
take
out?
Take these trips and come back to Atlanta because he'd tell me he'd been on the trips. This one's got a date on it, 95.
Yeah, these are 90, looks like 94. Must have been cold.
I don't know if those people were with him or just met up with him. Yeah, this one's 96. He must have went every year.
Did he ever say who took these pictures?
Ever say what?
Who took these pictures? Like who actually took the photo?
I think this was said it and get take it himself.
Is that his car?
Yeah. But the paper, the TV, said that he had a van now, not a truck.
Yes, ma'am.
Yeah. What will they do with this van?
Ma'am, we have it at our office right now. We're kind of looking through it and making sure we got all the things that are necessary for the case.
And I was just wondering if they could sell it and put the money so that he would be able to have some money for any incidentals he had. Where is he at right now?
We have him in a place called Dawson. I don't know if you're familiar with it. Dawsonville, Georgia.
Are you familiar?
Dawsonville.
Dawson's
kind of up north Georgia.
Yes.
Yeah. And he'll just be kept there a short time, though, won't he?
Yes, ma'am. We'll have him there. And actually, he's kind of got a really nice setup there right now. He's got his own area that's all his that he's private in. And last night he was talking about how much he liked it there, that it's warm. And that he can get food. He's getting 3 square meals a day. And he said, it's actually very nice for him. And he said, if I could stay here permanently, he said, I'd love to. But I think what's going to happen is after that, they'll move him to one of the jails in the northern Georgia area. But we're not sure about which one he's going to yet.
Okay. Will I be able to visit him as soon as I'm able to travel?
Yes, ma'am. Yes, ma'am. They have visitation, and that's not a problem. Are there any more pictures of him in there, ma'am?
Recent ones? I think you've got all the camping ones you've seen.
Can I look at those again real quick?
You looked at them.
Here's the, in the Vogel Park area, Blairsville area.
Yeah, he was. He was when this thing started out.
I believe that's a Union County.
Yes, it is. Yes, sir.
Is this Gary?
See, we have been to Vogel Park and Blood Mountain and such.
He was a beautiful child.
I don't think his mother has, but my wife and I have visited up in there a lot.
These are baby pictures.
Ma'am, I have a request, and you don't have to do it, ma'am, but is there any way that I could take these photos and give you a receipt for them and send them back to you and make copies for myself?
Let me see what you've got.
They're all the camping photos. There are no old photos of it, ma'am. And what I'll do is I'll write out a receipt so you know you can call the GBI and get me in trouble if I don't send them back.
How soon would you send them back?
Ma'am, I'd probably Monday, as soon as I can get money from my boss to go make... I know they're very dear, ma'am, and I'm real bad about... I don't like to give away my pictures, but...
The public defender, that's why I've got all these out together. She wants to see them.
Okay.
So I don't think she'll be back by then.
Yeah, I'll send them to you Monday morning, ma'am. I'll just go to a photo place and
have
them.
What do you think?
When is Betty due by?
I don't
know. Do you know this Betty would
speak up? No, he said he didn't know.
No, sir.
But she said, don't give anything.
She told me not to even talk to anybody.
Yeah.
But you'll send them back Monday.
Yes, ma'am. And a matter of fact, I'll go out to my car and get a receipt so you have a piece of paper with my phone number and my boss's phone number. And if I don't send it back Monday, you can yell at him. Have me in trouble.
What is the purpose of these?
I'd like to look and just see where he was at and just kind of get a sense of where he kind of hangs out at and the type of places that he would camp out and that sort of thing.
What do you think?
Well, now you don't want to get off on the wrong foot with her, because she may stripe her legs if, you know, she does something she's not supposed to, but with
I don't want to do anything to hurt my son,
but I want to
do everything I can to help him, because no matter what he's done, my son, and I believe...
He's
I
your
really
boy,
believe
man.
This is something that started in September.
Real quick, before we go on about that, do you know anything about what happened in September? Did he ever tell you?
Just
what he heard on the
I
news?
Haven't talked to him since about when I talked to him
about the
$10,000.
Yes, ma'am. Okay. That might just be the case. We're not 100% sure, but that's probably that sounds like that was a major, very, very emotional event for Gary. Whatever happened between this guy and Gary apparently upset him very much. I mean, that's all we know, though, to be honest.
Between my husband and...
Between the guy that you saw on the news.
Between Gary and his...
His employer.
His employer. His boss, man.
Oh.
Yeah, that's the thing we were talking about. That happened in September.
Yeah,
that was something that upset Gary, it appears. And I'm supposed to talk to him Monday afternoon about it, as a matter of fact. And we didn't have time last night to really talk about it, but...
Okay.
Yeah, and that seems like whatever it is that happened between the two of them... And of course, you always have two stories, you know. So I've heard the guy you saw on the news story. I'd like to hear Gary's side of it before I make any judgments or anything.
Well, he said that Gary worked for a while after that, but then it got so bad, him insisting on money until he had to fire him because he's making threats to him.
Okay.
That's what we heard.
Oh, that Gary was making threats to the employer.
To the employer.
Yeah. I'll tell you what.
Listen, if you send him back Monday...
Let me ask you this. I'll send him back Monday, but... If I can find a Photoshop around here, can I just leave them in your mailbox or something like that?
Oh, you can't get them in my mailbox, though.
Well, I'll just bring them. Are you going to be at the house for a while?
I'm going to be here. I'm going to go to the bank, and I should be back in about an hour.
Well, don't change your day. This is what we'll do, ma'am. If I can't find a Photoshop in the area, I'll put them on an envelope and leave them on your front porch. And will that work?
If you'll send them back Monday, okay. If you'll get them in Monday's mail... I'll get them by Wednesday.
Okay, ma'am. What I'm going to do is go get you a receipt with my phone number on it. I'll be right back if that's okay. I won't take up any more of your time there, ma'am.
I'm thinking of the one of the.
What about Walgreens? Do they usually have a?
That's, I think that's what we're going to try to find.
Okay. Dorchester. Go to the left. Okay. No, to the right. When you get here to Dorchester.
Yeah, we came down Dorchester.
Okay. Go to the right. And up at about the third traffic light, there'll be a Walgreens on the left-hand side.
Okay.
On the left-hand side.
Is that, would that be past the, post office is? Or is that the right
road? You're going the wrong direction.
Okay.
You're going to turn right here.
Okay, turn right
and
out
right
here.
Here. And go to this Dorchester right there. It's going to block.
Okay.
And turn to the right.
Turn to the right.
It's about the third light.
Yeah, that's the third. There'll be a big Bosch BOSCH plant on the left.
Okay.
Past that.
Yeah, just past that.
Well, it's a little ways of.
There is a little Lutheran church on the left.
Okay.
Very picturesque.
But you can't miss Walgreens.
Okay.
No.
You have to go through the light and make a turn on the street to get into the parking lot.
Okay.
But when you see that little church.
But there's about six churches between here and there.
Get in the left turning lane. Because at that next traffic light is where Ashley Phosphate, CVS Pharmacy, and.
But they're on the opposite side.
Yeah. So, and then
I
you'll
just get
turn.
In the left lane, stay in the left lane all the way.
Okay. Yeah. We'll find it.
Yeah. But now, if you need something like. One of the big copy places, you can they could go right on down Ashley Phosphate, and where you see the Walmart store, you'll see the big copy place there.
But if Walgreens would do it, that's the nearest one.
Okay.
Yeah. Yeah, Walgreens will be your nearest. No, we had planned if you had brought the media with you, you would not have gained entrance.
No.
Because we had talked by phone, and we were not going to allow you entrance.
I can assure you, we probably hate the media. More than you know, there has been no way that we would be associated with the media. They are a headache for us.
Well, I just told her, since this thing transpired, you know, be careful who you talk to because
they trick.
The media can come on so convincing. I'm
your
friend.
You're absolutely
Everyone
right.
else is your enemy. I'm your friend.
You're absolutely right.
Yep.
I put yours back in there.
Thank you, ma'am. And what I did was, just to walk you through this, is the photos of Gary Hilton, nothing further, so I can't add anything on there. That's my name. That's the case agent. Basically the boss man of the case, and I've already signed it. If you would just resign it, and what this says is relinquished by you to me.
Okay.
And then
Before
I'll
sign it.
Just right above it, ma'am.
Okay.
Right here.
I think it should just put to be returned.
I can put that on there.
Okay.
Here, ma'am, this is my card right here, and I'll give you the back page of this receipt, but this is my office number. My boss works at that number. And then I wrote my cell phone on there.
Oh, okay.
If you need to get in touch with me. Here's the copy of the receipt, ma'am.
Here's your pen.
Thank you.
Now, you're out of Atlanta.
Yes, sir.
And we'll get these back as soon as I make copies of them, ma'am. Okay. I'll put them in the mail. All right. Well, ma'am, we'll get out of your hair. I know you got a big day planned. You got to go to the bank and everything. Ma'am, another thing about that, if you think about anything like that comes into your mind that might be important, feel free to give me a call and just... You know,
okay,
if it's anything that comes to mind, and what I don't want to limit you or anything like that. If you think of something that you forgot to tell me, or something that, you know, an event that happened to Gary that sticks out in your head, even when he was a real small kid, feel free to give me a call at any time, ma'am. Just go ahead and call me, and I'll be around. If it's the middle of the night, that's when I do all my best thinking, so I'll probably be up. So feel free to give me a call, and I will get your photos back to you as soon as we make copies of them. But it was a pleasure meeting you, ma'am.
Thank you.
Nice meeting you, ma'am.
Sir?
Nice meeting you.
Have a nice day.
Mr. Howard. And Mr. Yoda.
Nice meeting you, sir.
Nice meeting you. I appreciate the kindness and courtesy that you've shown to my sister. Because she's been under a lot of pressure.
Is there any questions I can answer for you, ma'am, or anything? Any questions?